get started, let me say thank you to Michelle and to Benjamin and Johan for inviting me here. It's so beautiful here. It's the first time I've been here too, and so really, it's fantastic. More than I ever imagined. And also, before I get started, I want to acknowledge my colleagues who are working with me on quantum annealing at Lincoln Lab and MIT campus. In particular, Jamie Kerman. The two of us together got this program going at Lincoln 5 or 6 years ago. And you know, I'll show you some results from what we've done so far and why we're doing it. Let me also recognize two students, Tim Menke and Gabriel Samak, and also some leads at Lincoln. Donna Rosenberg leads 3D integration. Steve Weber is leading the experimental effort, and Jonathan Yoder is leading the fabrication effort. Okay, so by way of introduction, let me talk about some different quantum computing approaches. I think we all know the universal fault-tolerant quantum computing approach. Okay, Shor's algorithm is an example, but just one example. Grover's algorithm is another example. And here, you know, we use gates, and I'll talk about that in a moment, to implement a quantum algorithm. And we know that a quantum speedup exists if we can build a machine large enough to do something interesting. So that's a holy grail. And on the path to that holy grail is a, you know, you could think of it as a subset of that, which is a digital and analog quantum simulator. The example shown here is quantum chemistry, nitrogen fixation to produce ammonia. It's a very nice paper if you haven't read it. But, you know, there are others. There's material science and drug discovery. And again, here, a quantum speedup is known to exist if we can build this system. Now, the third type of quantum computer that I'm going to talk about today is called a quantum annealer, and by extension, an adiabatic quantum computer. And here, the purpose of a quantum annealer in particular is to do optimization problems, classical optimization problems. So things like pattern recognition, needle in a haystack problems, sensor satellite tasking. And here, we do not know if a quantum speedup exists over known classical algorithms. It hasn't been proven that it will exist, and nor has it been proven that it won't exist. But because optimization problems are so important, they're ubiquitous, I think it's worthwhile to understand if quantum annealers will ever give us some quantum advantage. And even if it doesn't, if it gives us a substantial classical advantage, that's still very important. Okay, so that's motivation to get into this. And I think we're all familiar with the D-Wave system, at least we've heard of it, and hopefully we'll learn more about it today. This is basically what it looks like. And, you know, there's been a lot of press about D-Wave's systems. And, you know, some of it is quite hypey. So you can just read, I won't read through all of these here, but, you know, a lot of mistaken claims have been made in the press, as, you know, that's the way it usually goes. But in the background, if we remove all of that, we've had some pretty serious scientists question whether this is real or not. Okay, highlighted here. And so Umesh Vazirani, for example, I bet there's no speed up. Okay, he's on one side. Matthias Troyer is a bit more balanced, saying, you know, we don't see a speed up, but that doesn't mean one doesn't exist. And I actually agree with him. We just don't know, right? And then, of course, there's Jordy Rose, who was the former CEO of D-Wave. You know, he, very outspoken guy. Okay. And, you know, if you look at this, you know, many wrong things were said in this Time magazine article, but the one thing that was said, I think, correctly is that we just don't understand how it works yet, right? Or if it's going to work, we don't understand yet how it's going to give us quantum speed up. So that part is true. And so if we look at a 2x2 matrix of classical and quantum computation, and then, you know, this universal computation versus optimization, you can see these, you know, four quadrants. But what's important to note is that for computation, we're looking for, we want to solve a problem deterministically, that there's a unique solution, Shor's algorithm, we do factoring. And when we factor the number into two primes, there are two numbers, right? Optimization is different. You know, if you're trying to find the fastest route home, or say the shortest route home, and you've got, say, 1,000 different options at your disposal, and 20 of them differ by only a few centimeters, you probably really don't care if you have the optimal solution or something that's just a high quality solution. It's good enough. And so that's a big difference between optimization and computation. We need to remember that, because there are many cases where with an annealer you may not get the true ground state or the true answer, but you can get potentially a high quality solution. And then asking how high quality solutions can give you quantum speed up, or determining the speed up of that, that's a very, very difficult problem. Okay. So again, just to reiterate that, you know, with quantum computing, there are several problems where there's a proven exponential speed up. But with quantum annealers of the D-wave type or some extension therein, we just don't know yet. Okay, so then you might say, okay, well, why should we do this? And the answer is that, as I mentioned, classical optimization is ubiquitous, and it touches us in just about all activities that we do. So I won't read through all these bullets, but we're, you know, resource allocation, scheduling, data processing, constraint satisfaction problems, verification and validation, machine learning. You know, even if a quantum optimizer can impact only one or two of these, it's a huge, huge impact on our everyday lives. And so that's why we're doing it. Okay. Now, I wanted to list a few references here. The various references are going to appear every time I have an outline slide, so you don't have to jot them all down right now. And you'll find them all at our website, equis.mit.edu. The references we have are a review paper on quantum annealing. It's on the archive. We have a quantum engineer's guide to superconducting qubits that is also on the archive, but just came out in publication. The current state of play of superconducting qubits, a bit shorter, on the archive. And then a couple years ago, we published some early work on 3D integration. So please, you know, take a look at those. Okay, so here's the outline. Before we get into quantum annealing, I'd like to talk first about the gate model quantum computer and then adiabatic quantum computing. We'll then get into quantum annealing itself and classical optimization, classical Monte Carlo, simulated annealing, and quantum annealing. And then we'll look at some hardware to implement quantum annealing, what the current practice is, the D-Wave system, what its limitations are, and how we might make improvements in the search for quantum enhancement of some type. And then the last part is 3D integration, which is applicable to both quantum annealing as well as gate model applications. Okay, so let's get into it. We know that universal computers, whether they're classical or quantum, operate based on a universal set of gates. And what I've listed here is a universal set of classical gates, including NOT gate, AND gate, OR gate, etc. And we know that we can form a universal set, which means we can perform any arbitrary Boolean logic with a handful of these gates. One example is the NOT and the AND gate. Another one would be the NAND gate. Okay, there are many, it's not unique. And similarly, with quantum computing, there's a universal set of single qubit and two qubit quantum gates. So here are the list of single qubit gates. Here are a couple two qubit gates. And again, you can form a universal set. Here's one example. And with a universal set of quantum gates, you can perform any quantum logic algorithm in a two state. And in this case, it's for two state systems. Okay, so I'd like to go through an example of quantum parallelism and quantum interference in gate model, because we'll look at the analog of that in quantum annealing in a moment. And so to get into that, let's imagine that we have three two-level systems. Let's say they're spins. There's a spin up and a spin down corresponding to 0 and 1. And classically, we can represent that in a state register from all spins up to all spins down, with this, you know, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1. And we note that there are 2 to the n classical states, in this case 8, but classically we only represent one at a time. Now, quantum mechanically, we know we can form a superposition of these states. So it's a single state, psi, with all of these aspects, with coefficients c1 through c8. You can write it this way, which looks a little bit more like a binary computer. And these coefficients, of course, are complex. So it takes 8 complex numbers to describe a single state. Okay, and we can put those in our state register here, C1 through C8, and now it's a quantum state register. Okay, so now let's look at superposition, or sorry, parallelism and interference. So here's an example of quantum parallelism. We have a pulse, it's a pi pulse. We're gonna shine it on atom one. And so what it's gonna do is if there's a spin pointed to the north pole on the block sphere, it'll rotate at 180 degrees to the south pole and vice versa. And so what that does to our state register is it shuttles coefficients. So here's the state register before and after this pulse. And so anywhere we have a spin up, the coefficients C1 through C4 are going to shuttle down to spin down. And anywhere that there's a spin down, C5 through C, it's going to shuttle up to spin up. Okay, so we applied one pulse on one atom, and we basically shifted around eight different coefficients. And that's an example of quantum parallelism in this state space notation. Now, we can also look at an example of quantum interference. And what we'll do this time is we'll have a pulse with half the height and the same duration, so it's a pi over 2 pulse, applied to atom 3. And again, we'll do before and after. Now, in this case, if we rotate a spin up to a superposition of up plus down, let's assume that it's pointing in this direction. We'll associate that with a plus sign. I'm not worried about normalization. We can see what happens to, say, this spin up and its coefficient C5. So it's going to shift or shuttle over to up plus down, and it comes in with a plus sign on both of these. Now, had we instead started at the south pole with a spin down and rotated it in the same direction, 90 degrees, we now get a minus sign. And so we can see what happens with coefficient C6 associated with this downspin. And it, of course, shuttles, but now it comes in with this minus sign, okay, as you would expect here. And so what this is quantum interference, because if C5 and C6 were equal, we would get constructive interference here, destructive interference here, and in fact, it would go away completely, right? But it's also an example of quantum parallelism because it happens on the entire state register at the same time. Again, one pulse, but it affects all components of this single quantum state. Okay. So in this gate model approach, we apply gates. So one example being the classical NOT gate, which takes 0 to 1, and a quantum version of that is the X gate taking 0 to 1. And we can visualize this on the block sphere as rotating from the north pole to the south pole by applying this pulse along the X direction. That's why it's called an X gate. Okay, and it rotates 180 degrees, so it's a pi pulse. Now, at this point, this is just a classical gate. It's just taking 0 to 1. But it gets more interesting in that the block vector, of course, can point anywhere on the surface of the Earth. And so it can rotate, or again, 180 degrees around the x-axis, but from a superposition state to another. And what it does is basically swaps these alpha and beta coefficients. Okay. And so here's an example of some single qubit gate fidelities from our group, showing the different single qubit gates, not just x, but the other ones, and doing randomized benchmarking on them. Now, for two-qubit gates, we'll look at the controlled knot as an example. And its classical analog is the XOR. So you have two inputs now, a control bit and a target bit. You get XOR out, and of course, you can carry the X forward if you want to use it again. The truth table is shown here. And the quantum version, okay, written in this way, is you're going to have input and output, but two qubits, control and target qubit. And you'll see that the, you know, aside from the Ket notation, this Dirac notation, everything else looks similar. So the rotation on qubit Y will depend on the state of qubit X. And so we can take a look at what happens with a state like this, where you have as your input a superposition state, 0 plus 1 for your X qubit and 0 for the Y qubit. Okay, so when you do that, you can take them one at a time. 0, 0, okay, is going to go to 0, 0, so we just rewrite that here. But 1, 0 is going to rotate because the state of qubit Y is going to rotate if X is a 1. And so this becomes a 1, 1. And now we see that this is an entangled state. Okay. It cannot be factored into something that's X cross Y. Okay. So again, you know, just to summarize, universal gates or gate-based quantum computing is achieved by applying these types of gates, single and two-qubit gates, from a universal set, and in doing so, you can access anywhere in the Hilbert space. Okay, and just to give some examples of fidelities that we've got using randomized benchmarking, we're about 99.5% for the CZ gate, and we can do process tomography and get about 99%, where the state preparation is included, but the measurement error is subtracted off to get to this number. Okay, good. So then the point of all this is to say, if we do an algorithm using the gate model, this is a very typical way that it happens, is you have an input state that you put into a massive superposition state. Okay, so maybe you apply a Hadamard to every single qubit individually, right? And you will then do a series of gates, such as a single qubit operation like we described, applied to one of the qubits, but affecting the entire state register. That's followed by interference, which changes the coefficients. Then we do coupled qubit operations where, you know, qubit A rotates depending on the state of qubit B, again followed by quantum interference. And at the end of the day, you get an output state, and if you've designed the algorithm well and you ran it well, almost all of the probability amplitude resides in front of one of these states, so that when we make a measurement with very high probability, we get that, and that, of course, encodes the answer to the problem. Okay. And in the context of annealing, the reason to go all through all this is that the answer we got here is almost certainly an excited state of the system. It is not the ground state, right? I don't know where it is. It depends on the algorithm and what the answer was, but it's somewhere in the energy spectrum, which is why T1 matters so much in these qubits. Okay, so now let's shift and look at adiabatic quantum computing. And the concept here is that you have a Hamiltonian, and it has two parts, an initial part and a problem part. And the initial part is where you start. You start with an initial Hamiltonian where you know the ground state well. And in fact, again, applying a large X field, or putting everything along X, is a great place to start, because we know that the ground state is all these along X. But in the computational basis, that looks like a massive superposition state. Now, you then have a problem Hamiltonian whose ground state you're looking for, but you don't know. It's a hard problem to find it. And the idea is that you gradually turn off your initial Hamiltonian while you gradually turn on the problem Hamiltonian. And you do that by ramping adiabatically, changing this as slowly as need be so that you never leave the ground state. At least that's the ideal situation. And so this adiabaticity depends on the minimum gap in the energy levels as you undergo this annealing or this adiabatic schedule. And, you know, Dorit Aharonov and colleagues back in 2004 showed that adiabatic quantum computing is polynomially equivalent to gate model quantum computing. It means it's as powerful. And it means something important also is that for those problems in particular, the minimum gap that one has decreases only polynomially with the system size, right? If it decreased exponentially with the system size, in principle, you'd have to go exponentially slowly through that gap in order not to have a Landau-Zener transition, right? And so this is an important fact, is that the minimum gap decreases only polynomially with the system size for these types of problems where a universal quantum computer will have a speed up. But it represents specific structure of the gate model problem, and it almost certainly requires that you remain in the ground state throughout this evolution. Okay, and as we'll see in a moment, that's a problem, because as the system gets big enough, even if the gap is decreasing, temperature will become a problem. Oh, I think that's just in principle you could have that. Yeah.
The goal is to determine the ground state. That's the only goal is to determine the.
Yeah, I'll talk about how we encode problems in this space in a bit. Yeah. Another question? Exactly.
I mean, well, like, it's some level.
Yeah. So what it means is, so I would kind of, let me do the contrast first, which is something that scales exponentially with the system size would be that if I count the number of bits or qubits that I need n in the system, then the this gap is going to decrease as some power to the n, or to the minus n, right? It's going to get smaller and smaller in an exponential sense. Whereas polynomially, you could have n to some, say, power, right? But that power is not n. So that's an example of polynomial.
But it's possible that like the polynomial in one model and the other of much higher order, or
I think in general when you say this polynomial comparison, right, you're not stating that it's a favorable polynomial, but it's not exponential. I think that's what you're saying. But in this case,
well,
as you're saying,
it's the mapping of a quantum circuit with L gates to a adiabatic computation that involves a Hamiltonian. Somewhat more qubits, but it will have a gap that's 1 over L squared. So that relates to the number of gates in your original quantum circuit, which is definitely polynomial with an efficient circuit in the number of qubits, right?
Right.
So it's an efficient quantum algorithm that you're trying to map.
But you need the algorithm. If you had a random spin glass problem, the gap would be exponentially small.
Right. And that's right, and that's going to be annealing. So we're going to get, yes, so annealing is basically like a spin glass, right? And at least the ones that we think of. That's the hard case.
Can you describe the gap between the Hamiltonian and the Hamiltonian
field? Oh, yeah, I'll get to that, if you can just hold on to that. Okay, so let's just think of it conceptually before we get into the details, which is that you start with some initial Hamiltonian whose ground state you know and you can prepare with, you know, very high probability. And you've arranged your qubits and connected them together according to some prescription. And then you have the problem Hamiltonian that you don't know the ground state, but you want to find it. Okay. And so the idea is that you apply fields to these qubits in such a way that you basically turn off this initial Hamiltonian and turn on the problem Hamiltonian. And this is, you know, very conceptual. It works for adiabatic, it works for quantum annealing as well. So as you do that, you change this, you know, this potential profile of the system, and eventually you change it in such a way where there's a new minimum, okay? And so then through a process of quantum tunneling, you can tunnel to that new minimum, okay? Now, that's not the only way you could get there. You could thermally bounce over the barrier, okay? Or you could do quantum tunneling. And of course, the process that we want is quantum tunneling. We could assume that we're at zero temperature, in fact. Okay. Yeah, so that's right. So maybe if I had enough patience, I could make this with small enough steps that you would notice it happening continuously, and that as soon as these energy levels became resonant, this thing would tunnel through and then just go down, right? Yeah.
We're on the level of the number continuous.
Yeah, quasi-continuous, that's right, yeah. Okay, and so you continue on and eventually, you know, reach the ground state, and that's the solution. Okay. So adiabatic quantum computing and annealing, the goal is to adiabatically evolve from a known starter Hamiltonian to a final Hamiltonian. You leverage quantum tunneling, and for adiabatic quantum computing, you must remain in the ground state. At least we don't know what happens if you get excited. And annealing is a way to relax this assumption because it's a recognition that you almost always will, in fact, leave the ground state for any problem that's of interesting size. Of course, you could do 4 qubits and make a big gap and anneal, go through that gap without exciting anything, but it's not an interesting problem. We could simulate that with a classical computer. But if you get to a problem that's hard for a classical computer, almost certainly these gaps are going to be very small compared to temperature for superconducting qubits. Now, there may be another modality where that gap is very large compared to temperature, and okay, that's a different story. Okay, so The reason we're concerned with adiabatic evolution is because of this gap. And so here we just look at a simple two-level system, sigma z and sigma x. The two dashed lines represent the diabatic states that cross, and then they are tunnel coupled in some way that gives you this splitting delta. So epsilon represents the distance between the diabatic states, and delta the distance between these eigenstates. And you have some parameter that you can tune, like epsilon, okay, this longitudinal term. And so if you go through this, we know that if we go through this slowly enough, that we'll stay in this ground state, right? And what does slowly enough mean? Well, it means that I don't have a Landau-Zener transition, which is basically shown here as the probability of doing a transition between these diabatic states, right, between the blue and the red. But the energy scales that you care about is basically delta squared, this gap squared, and then Planck's constant times this rate, which is a sweep velocity, which is basically how quickly are the energy levels changing in time. Okay, if you ramp slowly, they change slowly in time. If you ramp quickly, that's a high velocity. And so it's the ratio of these two in this exponent that tells you. Now, if you go in the opposite limit, where you're much faster, say, than this gap squared, then you'll just stay in the diabatic state. You won't even see the gap. You just blow right through it. Okay. All right. Now, you can go at intermediate speeds. And we've done a lot of work on that. I won't talk about it today. But in fact, if you go somewhere in between, you can actually split into ground and excited state, right, coherently, and accumulate a relative phase. These are at different energy levels. And in fact, if you then go back through the avoided crossing a second time, the wave function will interfere with itself, and it looks like an interferometer, because you can think of this as a beam splitter. Okay, and you pick up some relative phase in this gray region. But we're not going to talk about that today. But what we want is this adiabatic limit. Okay, and so adiabaticity depends on several things. It depends on the size of the gap, how fast you're going through it, but it also depends on the temperature. Right? You can think of temperature in a number of ways, but one way is to cause direct transitions. But you can also think about it as jiggling this parameter at some rate, and if it's jiggling faster and faster because the temperature is getting higher and higher, you might actually just have a Landau-Zener transition. Okay. So this is what it looks like in reality. Of course, it's not one qubit. It's many, many, many qubits with many, many energy levels. Okay. And you start at some point. I'm going in the other direction now. And you realize that, okay, well, I'm at a finite temperature now. Maybe I'm not entirely in the ground state. I have a little bit of population in the first excited state. And you undergo this annealing schedule. And in fact, you blow right through these two avoided crossings. And now you're higher up in the manifold. And you can have Landau-Zener transitions like we just described. You can have excitation to a higher rate levels. You can relax back down from those levels. And the complexity of the problem is dictated by all of these gaps and how small they are. So quantum annealing is basically a bet. And that bet is that, okay, I acknowledge I'm going to leave the ground state. And what I'm hoping for is that with all of these relaxation processes, I can bring myself back down to the ground state or closer to the ground state. Hopefully it's a non-degenerate ground state if I get there. If it's highly degenerate, it might split off again in the future, right? And quantum annealing is basically using this concept and applying it to what's called a transverse icing Hamiltonian. And we'll talk about that in a moment. And so the commercial quantum computers we have today, there are two of them. There's for example, IBM Q, which has a gate model quantum computer. Okay, and then there's D-Wave, which has this type of quantum annealing. Okay, are there any questions before I move on?
Change the speed according to.
Yeah, so if you had a way, and that is an idea that people are thinking about, if you do, say, constant feedback, and you have some metric that you can somehow assess the curvature of the levels, right, you might understand that you're coming close to an avoided crossing, maybe I should slow down. I think conceptually that's right, but in practice, again, you know, for many of these problems, that gap just gets so small that, you know, even if you slowed down, that temperature will get you in the end. But I think conceptually that's right. Okay, so let's talk about quantum annealing and classical optimization. So as we said, this looks exactly like, or very similar to quantum, adiabatic quantum computing. So again, you have the initial Hamiltonian, the problem Hamiltonian. Again, the initial we're gonna take to be all spins pointed in the x direction. Okay, just apply a large field. And the problem Hamiltonian now is called a transverse Ising Hamiltonian. It's the Ising model, and it's transverse because we mix in this transverse term here. So you'll notice in this classical Ising model that the single qubits are all in Z, and the couplings are all ZZ type coupling. Okay, so everything's Z, all commutes. Now, many of these Ising models, as Steve mentioned, they're spin glasses, right? So the couplings are random. And as a result, we know that the gap decreases exponentially with system size. That's as hard as it gets. And so again, we know that the system's gonna leave the ground state at some point during this evolution. And so what we're doing is we now have an annealing schedule, right? So it looks exactly like the adiabatic quantum computing. But what's happening is that this driver Hamiltonian, as it's called, or the this one here, the transverse field is being turned off. And as we turn it off, we're turning off effectively quantum fluctuations. We'll look at this, what that means, that jargon means in a moment. But as we turn them off, we're basically turning on this problem Hamiltonian and getting to a more and more classical Ising state. Okay. And it's this classical Ising model which contains the cost function, I'll show an example in a moment, that describes the problem that we're trying to solve. Now, it's important that these quantum fluctuations come from this initial Hamiltonian or driver Hamiltonian, and it doesn't commute, right? That's required to have quantum fluctuations. And the idea is that's, at least conceptually, that's how the system can explore the this large space. Why is that? Well, basically, if I'm saying that I have a large field in X, that's now my quantization axis, and so the ZZ coupling is transverse to that. But as I turn off the X field and turn on the Z field, okay, then everything now is longitudinal. Okay. So let's look at some classical optimization problems. One is called HOBO, which is high order polynomial unconstrained binary optimization, HOBO. So that's when you have many constraints, three or more, that you're trying to satisfy simultaneously. Since superconducting qubits generally are two-body or two local couplings, most times what you'll find, and D-Wave is like this, is it's called QBO, or quadratic unconstrained binary optimization. So just uses two local couplings. And the cost function that you're going to create looks like this. You have Boolean variables X can take value 0 or 1, and you can have the single variable or quadratic two-variable. And so, of course, most problems have higher order constraints. You just don't have hardware that can implement them directly, so you have to implement them in some way. So for example, if you had some constraint that required multiplying x1 times x2 times x3, what you can do is define a new variable x4 as x2 times x3. Okay, and obviously it's the same. And then in your cost function, you have to figure out a way to represent that. And so, for example, if you add to your cost function this term here, these four terms here, you can work it out on paper, but you'll find that this equals 0 if and only if x4 equals x2 times 3. And in every other case, it equals some positive number, which means it increases the cost, right? So that becomes unfavorable. But to do that, we had to use extra resources, right? There's no free lunch. And now, once you have this problem, or the cost function of the problem, you can map it onto your problem Hamiltonian just by making these associations. So, for example, sigma z is going to go to 1 minus 2x. Okay? And the coupling j is going to go to minus 1 over 4 times this d, okay, et cetera. And when you do that, you can easily show that you get your problem Hamiltonian back, which is just this Ising model, plus a constant energy offset, which we don't really care about. Okay. So that's how we do this mapping of a model onto our Ising system. So let's look at an example, traffic flow optimization. Okay, so here's the problem set up. Is you have a map, and it's divided into, you have several locations indicated by the dots, and the roads are these lines, and you have several cars, okay? And we'll label the cars by letters, and then the routes we're gonna label by R, okay? And so each car has a starting point, and it can follow, say, the green route to get from where it is to the airport, okay? And this is a different route, okay? And so across the top, you have routes 1 through 5, you have cars A through B. And the binary variables are each potential route that the car can take. Okay, those are, so car A on route 2 has this binary variable A, X, A2. Okay. Now, the costs come in when you have two cars that have, you know, two different routes, but those routes share some segments. And when they share segments, we want to implement a cost for doing that, right? Because that causes a traffic jam. Okay. So that's where the cost comes from. And so I've just replaced, so the x's now get replaced with variables, or their numerical representation, 0 or 1. And here, car B on route 1 and car A on route 2 have some connection. Okay. And the cost associated with that, which is going to be this d, right? Now both of these are 1, right? And when they overlap with some value d, which is the number of overlapping segments. So here there are 2, 1, 2, so we would set D equal to 2, okay? And we do that for all cars, all routes. Now, that's just a classical representation. In the Ising spin situation, you have variables, and we'll call them sigma for the spins, and of course spin can be +1 or -1, spin up or spin down. And so now you can see that that's represented over here. Again, these two are flipped with respect to all of the other ones. So in the mapping, the spins represent the binary variables, and the couplings, J, represent the costs. Okay. And so then you write down, you know, using the prescription that I just showed on a few slides ago, you can write down what H is in front of the single spin term, and what J is in terms of, you know, in front of the two local interaction, depending on the cost functions and, you know, that you have. Okay. And then the problem statement is that for a given set of H and J, find the spin configuration that minimizes this total energy. Okay, that's straightforward. And we don't know it a priori. Okay. So we can optimize this in a classical sense, and the way that that's done is you calculate the energy for a given set of variables, the spins, as a function of the configurations, all the different ways these spins could be oriented. And so there's quite a few of them depending on the size of the system, but I've indicated several dots here just to give examples of a particular configuration. That's the energy it has. For a different set of spin configurations, it has a different energy. Okay. So this is a needle in the haystack problem. Which one gives me the lowest energy? And can I find it without just brute force calculating all the energies? So in classical Monte Carlo optimization, you basically pick a random guess. You just pick some example and then calculate what its energy, or measure what its energy is. Okay. And then you randomly take steps. So for example, I flip one spin. That gives me this second configuration, and it has its own energy. In this case, it went up a little bit. Now, if you had chosen a different guess, you would have taken a different path through this configuration space. Okay, so path 1 and path 2, depends on which spins are flipped, okay? And then here's an example going through, et cetera. Now, in this case, we did actually get the low-cost solution, but that very rarely happens because, in principle, there's a very large number of these. And so the black ones indicate a particular path. The gray data here can correspond to a different path, and there are many, many different paths, obviously, that you can choose. Now, for this glassy landscape here, this potential landscape, which is quite glassy, there are exponentially many such configurations. And it's clear that if this is your potential profile, let's say, that a simple gradient descent method is going to obviously fail. Because if you are located, say, here, and you're just going to go down to this local minimum, it's local minimum, but it's not the global minimum. Okay? And the reason it fails is because there's so many mountain peaks. So to address that problem, there's a technique called simulated annealing, where annealing is basically when people used to make swords, they'd heat it up, bang on it, cool it down, heat it up, bang on it, cool it down. And so trying to reach a lower energy state, something that's maybe has a better configuration, makes it stronger, and so in a material sense, and so that's called annealing. And here we simulate that by effectively applying a temperature, and this illustration will show what it is. So you start at a high temperature where this fictitious particle is bouncing around in this space, and then you gradually lower the temperature. This is all being simulated, of course, and eventually you'll relax down to one of these local minima. Now, of course, you hope it's the global minima, but it doesn't have to be. And so in this case, of course, you got trapped in a local minima and missed the lowest one. So the concept, and this was from the mid to late 90s, Nishimori was one of the early proponents, but there were several works that went into this idea, was let's replace classical statistical fluctuations, temperature fluctuations, with quantum tunneling or quantum fluctuations and see what happens. Okay, and so rather than this classical icing spin state, you now have a quantum spin state, which can be in a superposition, right? It's quantum. And you have a Hamiltonian that we've already described in detail with a cost function as well as this driver, and the driver does not commute. That's important, right? The driver does not commute with the cost function in the icing model. Okay, and so what you have now, of course, is a quantum wave function which extends over this space, right? And where you look at this, you say, okay, it makes sense. Where the potential is deepest, I have more probability amplitude. And where the mountains are high, I have much less probability amplitude. But it does extend over the whole space. And this is what we mean by quantum fluctuations. Because if we made a measurement of such a wave function, create the same wave function identically many times and make a measurement, we'll randomly get one of these points according to magnitude squared of the wave function at a particular place, right? And then if we look at that classically, we have some probability distribution. It has a variance, which means it has a standard deviation. And in this sense, we have quantum fluctuations, right? That's what that means in this context. And so that's happening while we're changing the potential profile, right? And turning off the driver Hamiltonian and turning on the cost function. And at the same time, we also have impact from decoherence. We can't forget about decoherence. And what that's doing is, of course, it's extracting information. It's pushing us deeper into a well. Could be the well we want to go to, but it could also be a local minimum. And in the context of annealing, it may also be helping us. If we went to an excited state by accident, okay, then it may be pulling us back down. Okay, but it is. Continuously damping us towards a classical state. And these two effects are competing with one another in the annealer. So this is basically what it looks like. You have your cost function, you have the driver, and so the pink corresponds to the total energy here. The quantum fluctuation strength corresponds to the driver Hamiltonian. We're going to gradually turn that off. And of course, we expect that even though we're turning on the cost function, hopefully we're getting to lower and lower energies overall. And so now we'll just take a few steps through this to see how it looks. So when the quantum fluctuation strength is high, this wave function is largely extended. But as we decrease the driver Hamiltonian, you can see that the wave function is starting to coalesce into one of these lower energy states. So it's still tunneling, but the strength of that tunneling is less so. Okay. And eventually, we are projected out into one of the classical states. Okay. Again, it's not the global minimum, it's a local minimum. Oh, sorry, that meant to indicate what we got from simulated annealing. In this case, we're assuming that we did actually go to the global minimum, okay, through this process. Good, it worked. But if you look at this, you could ask, okay, well, what's the role of quantum coherence in this system, right? If I'm always trying to get to the ground state, sure, maybe I should just relax. Well, of course, we need quantum tunneling, so we can't turn off quantum mechanical effects completely. But there's something that's even more maybe subtle, but the process by which we go from one spin configuration to another spin configuration can be thought of in terms of a transition matrix analysis, where you have to look at every pathway to go from one configuration to the final configuration. And there are many pathways, spin flips, that one can do that. And those in a coherent system will all coherently add together to bring you to some final state. And in a system without coherence or with very low coherence, those spin flips may happen individually, but they don't coherently add together. And that's the role of quantum coherence in this system. So it is quantum interference. This is how quantum interference is manifest in a quantum annealer and needed, right? And it is parallelism because it's happening across this whole wave function at the same time. Okay. I'm not sure if that was clear, but I think this is an intuitive picture of why coherence is likely important in a quantum annealer. And we can't just say that, yeah, quantum annealers, it's a ground state, so we don't care about coherence because we're trying to get to a ground state.
So
it's bad terminology. When I said classical state, I didn't mean that necessarily we were relaxing to one of the spin configurations. It relaxes to an eigenstate. That's right. Provided that there's enough tunneling to create that eigenstate, right?
Yeah.
So
these are very nullable transitions.
That's right. And then, you know, one can also imagine that there's a distance over which maybe the whole computer isn't entirely coherent, but locally there's some distance over which there's coherence and reasonable levels of tunneling, and somewhere else where